doing that. Thank you. Thank you. Wow. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Thank you for being here. Texas does everything really big. Thank you very much. This is incredible. Thank you very much. I'm so honored to be with all of you. Thank you for coming here today to listen to me, and I appreciate very much the fact that you're here today. And I want to talk to you about this election and the future of America. And I hope that I can earn the vote and the support of every single person here, and that you'll go out and find more people to support this cause, because this election is so critical for the future of America. So let's start with something that I think every one of us would agree with. All right, Jesus. Get out of here. We'll let them take care of that. That has never happened before. That has never. Hey. All right, let's start again. Let's rewind it. Guys, if it happens again, I'm just going to take a sip of water. This is the greatest country in the history of the world. The greatest country in the history of the world. People can say outrageous things and not go to jail because we're a free people. This is an extraordinary nation founded on the idea, the principle, that our rights do not come from the government. We were founded on the principle that our rights come from God. That makes us different. So you know what flowed from that right? Our embrace of free enterprise. An extraordinary economic system where you can go as far as your talent and your work will take you. And as a result, we became the most prosperous people in the world. We embraced individual liberty that made us the freest people that have ever lived. And the result was this extraordinary country, a nation that has served as an inspiration to people everywhere, a nation that has drawn people like my parents in search of a better life. There has never in the history of mankind been a country like America, ever. But I want you to understand that now, as I run for president, I get to travel America quite a bit. I get to go to Texas. I get to obviously spend a lot of time in Iowa and New Hampshire and South Carolina and Nevada. I get to talk to people everywhere at the grocery store in my hometown of Miami. And I want to share with you that people are really frustrated and concerned. And maybe you are as well. They say things to me like, I don't recognize my own country anymore. They say things to me like, I feel left out in my own country. I feel out of place in my own land. I feel like an outsider in the nation that I grew up in. And the question we have to ask ourselves is, why is this happening? Why is it that the greatest country in the world feels like it's headed in the wrong direction so fast? And I believe it's because in 2008, the United States elected as president a person who wasn't interested in fixing what was wrong with America. We elected someone as president who wanted to fundamentally and radically change America. And we are paying the price. We elected as president someone that does not believe in free enterprise. They give lip service to free enterprise, but they do not believe in it. They believe free enterprise is a flawed system in which only a few people make all the money and everybody else gets left behind. And that's why today you see this rhetoric that basically makes it sound like if you are successful, if you've made money, if your business is doing well, you must have done something wrong. You must be cheating your customers. You must be cheating your employees. And so they undermine free enterprise, a government takeover of our economics. A government takeover of healthcare, even an effort to have the federal government, take over our schools through Common Core. You can go ahead and clap because I don't like it either. You have a president that views the Constitution of the United States as an annoyance, as an outdated and stale document to be worked around instead of followed. And so that's how you have basically an all-out assault on the Second Amendment, an obsession with undermining the Second Amendment, an obsession with undermining the religious liberties of all Americans, a habitual and continual undermining and ignoring of every level of the Constitution. Third, you have a president that looks with great suspicion at Americans with traditional values. I'm not making that up. He has said it. Americans with traditional values are bitter people that cling to their guns and to their religion. Somebody said amen. But not because you're bitter, but because it's our right. And then you have a president that views America as an arrogant global power. Not a great nation, but a nation that needs to be humbled, cut down to size. And that's why you get what we have now. We have a foreign policy that we cut deals with our enemies, but we betray our allies. And we're destroying our military. We are eviscerating our military with these defense cuts. And you have a president that goes around the world apologizing for America on 10 separate occasions, apologizing for America. And the result is what you see now in America, this deep frustration, this anger. And the anger isn't just at the Democrats. The anger isn't just at Barack Obama. It would be foolish to believe that. They're angry at Republicans. They're angry at Washington. They're angry at everybody. And they have a right to be. Because never before in our history has Washington been more out of touch than it is right now. This is why I ignored Washington in 2009. When I ran for the U.S. Senate in 2009, my opponent was the governor of Florida, the incumbent governor of Florida, and the entire leadership of the Senate, every single one of them, told me, we are supporting him and you better not run. And I ignored him and we won. Yeah. And now when I decided to run for president, some of the exact same people came forward again and said, you can't run. It's not your turn. You gotta get in line, you have to wait. And I asked myself, wait for what? Wait for what? This is no time for patience after 7 years of Barack Obama. If we get this election wrong, there may be no turning back for America. And so that's why I chose to run for president. That's why I'm proud to be with you here today. Because the first thing this country needs is a president that understands what our people are facing, and I understand. You know why I understand what people are facing? Because I have lived many of the same things people are facing. I want to know, how is Hillary Clinton going to lecture me about people that live paycheck to paycheck? Because I grew up paycheck to paycheck. I have lived paycheck to paycheck. I want to know how she's going to lecture me about student loans. I actually had a student loan. I paid it off just 4 years ago with my book, An American Son, now available on paperback, if you're interested. Why do people always laugh when I say, it's true, it's available on paperback. I want you to buy it. Anyway. And American Dreams, the follow-up to it too, but anyway, all right. So, it doesn't matter because I'm gonna win Powerball tonight and none of this will, yeah. Yeah, the taxes, exactly right, the taxes. I want to know how she's going to lecture me on how hard it is to raise children in the 21st century, since Jeanette, my wife of 17 years, and I are raising 4 children in the 21st century. And it is harder than ever. We have to work harder every year that goes by to ensure that our children grow up with the values that we teach in our home and in our church, instead of the values that they're trying to ram down our throat in the movies, in music, in the media, in the popular culture. I understand what people are facing because I faced it myself, because people that I love in my family are facing it now. We do need a president that is frustrated and angry and upset about the direction of our country, but that alone will not be enough. We also need a president that knows what to do about it. We also need a president that knows exactly what it will take to turn America around, and I do, and when I'm president, we will do it. And it will begin on my very first day. On my very first day, the first thing I'm going to do is take the oath of office, which means I'm going to place my left hand on the Bible and my right hand in the air, and I am going to swear before the nation and under the eyes of God to defend and protect and uphold the Constitution of the United States, and unlike Barack Obama, I will actually do that. And what that means is I won't be meeting with the Attorney General to conspire about how could I figure out a way to undermine the Constitution. I will have an Attorney General that defends the Constitution and your rights. I'm not going to appoint judges to the Supreme Court or any court for that matter who believe that the Constitution is a living and breathing document, malleable, changeable, depending on what we want it to be. We will appoint justices to the Supreme Court and all of our courts that understand that the Constitution is to be applied and interpreted as originally intended. And then I'm going to get to the Oval Office. And on my first day in office, I'm going to walk in, I'm going to sit behind the desk, and I am going to immediately repeal every single one of Barack Obama's unconstitutional executive orders. So what does that mean? That means all of these crazy rules from the EPA, the Employment Prevention Agency is what I call them, the EPA. Every single one of their crazy rules on my first day in office, they're gone. Every single one of them. Any ongoing effort by any federal agency to impose Common Core on our school districts on my first day in office, those efforts are gone. On my first day in office, this crazy, ridiculous, and reckless deal with the Ayatollah of Iran on my first day in office, that deal is canceled. There's more work to be done. We need to fix our political process. Let me tell you how you're not going to fix certain things. We need term limits in America on our members of Congress. We need term limits on judges. We need a balanced budget amendment. If you are waiting for Congress to pass term limits on themselves, you are going to be waiting a very, very long time. Here's the good news. I believe with all my heart, one of the reasons why I know America is a nation set apart and blessed by God is that it happened to be a place where there were multiple geniuses all living together at the same place at the same time. And they were the framers of our Constitution. And you know what they did? They wrote into the Constitution, particularly Madison, a provision under Article 5 that allowed you, the people, to take control of your government if the federal government got out of control. I think the federal government's out of control. Now is the time to use that. And here's how. There is a citizen effort now called Convention of the States. And what it says is that the people of the United States, working through the states, can call a constitutional convention, a limited one, meaning they can't open up the First Amendment, they can't take away the Second Amendment, it'll be a very limited convention. Here's the only thing they will be able to do. Term limits on Congress, term limits on the Supreme Court and all federal judges, and a balanced budget amendment. When I'm president of the United States, I will lend the power, the voice of the presidency behind that effort. The president doesn't have to sign it. Congress doesn't have to pass it. The people are going to do it, and we're going to take control of our federal government again so it doesn't continue to expand. Everyone running for president is against Obamacare as a Republican, every one of them. I am the only one that's ever done anything about it of meaning. This is actually a great example of how big business loves big government, okay? In 2009, when they were debating Obamacare, the big insurance companies went to Obama and Pelosi and Reid and said, "We'll support Obamacare, but you have to create a bailout fund. If we lose money on this deal, we want to be bailed out, and we want the taxpayers to do it." And that's what they did. In Obamacare, they created a bailout fund with taxpayer money. Well, in 2014, I was able to get that bailout fund wiped out, and we saved the American taxpayer $2 billion. Now, some of the experts, quote unquote, are saying that because of the loss of this bailout fund, Obamacare might collapse. I hope so. But whether it does or doesn't, when I'm president of the United States, we will once and for all repeal and replace Obamacare, and we're going to put you back in charge of health insurance decisions. When I'm president, we're going to re-embrace free enterprise. It works. Free enterprise works. It is the only economic model in the history of the world where you can make and help poor people get richer without making rich people poorer. It is the only economic model where everyone can rise up without anyone being pulled down. And we're going to re-embrace it when I'm president. See? Thank you. I think it tells you how far we've come as a country that a president has to say, I am for free enterprise. But we're going to mean it. Well, you know, presidents don't create jobs. I always chuckle when I hear a governor or a mayor or a politician say, I created 1 million jobs when I was whatever. Well, that's true. That means you grew government by 1 million jobs. The private sector creates jobs. You know what our job is? Our job is to put in place policies that make America the easiest and the best place in the world for the private sector to create those jobs. And so it will be among my highest priorities to reform our tax code, both personal and business, to make America the most competitive economy on the planet. It will be my priority to roll back federal regulations and cap them with a regulatory budget that limits how much federal regulations can cost our economy. And here's what else we're going to do when I'm president of the United States. We are going to fully utilize all of the energy resources that God has blessed America with. And so, as long as it's driven by the market, I want us to lead the world in wind and solar and renewables and biofuels and energy efficiency. If the market bears it, I want to lead the world in all of that. But we are going to produce more oil and more natural gas when I am president of the United States. And we're going to continue to use coal, by the way. I don't want anybody who likes coal to be upset. So we're definitely going to do that. It's important in many parts of this country that really rely on that. I want to talk about an issue that's always debated, and that's immigration. And I want you to listen to me carefully on this, because what I'm about to tell you is absolutely true. There is no one running for president, no one, who understands this issue personally better than I do. My father was an immigrant. My mother was an immigrant, and my grandparents were immigrants. My wife's entire family are immigrants. I grew up in a community of immigrants, and I live today in a community of immigrants. Literally, every one of my neighbors is an immigrant or first generation. I know every aspect of this issue. The good, the bad, the ugly. I've seen it all. Not read about it in a book, didn't watch a documentary on Frontline. I've seen it with my own eyes and in my own life. Let me tell you something, this issue has changed. A couple years ago when we debated this issue, when we talked about this issue, even as recently as a year ago, the focus was on what do you do with someone who came and have been here 15 years and have not, you know, violated the immigration laws but is otherwise a good person and is just here for a better life. And that's all still happening. That's still part of the debate. But this issue has fundamentally changed because we now have a radical apocalyptic jihadist group that is using our immigration system against us. ISIS is trying to use our legal immigration system against us. They are actively recruiting people to come into this country on visa waivers, as refugees, as doctors, as fiancés. They are using our legal immigration system, and they understand our vulnerabilities on illegal immigration, and they're trying to exploit that too. And so this issue has changed. Let me tell you what it reminds me of. There was a time not long ago in many communities in America where people literally did not lock their doors at night. Maybe there was a time they did that in Dallas too. But there was a time not long ago where people didn't lock their doors. Why didn't they lock their doors? Because they didn't have to. What's going to happen? And then the world changed. Everyone here locks their doors. I think you do. Why do you lock your doors? Do you hate the people outside your home? You lock your doors because you love the people inside your home. And that's why immigration today is different from what it was 5 or 10 years ago, because there's a group that's trying to use the system against us. And so when I'm president of the United States, if we don't know 100% for sure who you are and 100% for sure why you are trying to come, we're not going to be able to let you in, because our number one obligation is to keep us safe. And when I'm president, we're not going to support have amnesty. There has to be real consequences for violating the law. And if you're a city that is flouting our immigration laws, a sanctuary city, you're going to lose your federal funding. And if you're a criminal... And if you're a criminal, you're going to be deported. And one more thing. As the son of immigrants, as the grandson of immigrants, I can say this to you with authority. Enforcing our immigration laws is not anti-immigrant. It is what sovereign countries do. And we have failed to do it. And there's no excuse for it. We know what it will take to enforce our laws, and Texas is a state that's deeply impacted by it. What will it take? It will take really completing, actually doing the 700 miles of walls and fencing that is required by law, but they've never done. It means hiring at least 15,000 to 20,000 new Border Patrol agents. It means having at least $3 or $4 billion of new technology and sensors and cameras on key sectors of the border. By the way, not just because people are trying to cross, but because drugs are trying to cross and potentially terrorists as well. It means having a mandatory E-Verify system to shut off the jobs magnet that draws people here illegally. It means having an entry-exit, biometric entry-exit tracking system so that if someone overstays a visa, we know who they are, where they are, and how to find them. That's about 40% of the problem right there. And if we do all of those things, we are going to bring illegal immigration under control. The last issue I wanted to raise that I'll deal with as president will be the first, and that's national security. It is the most important thing the federal government does. The most important title of a president is commander-in-chief, not golfer-in-chief, not accountant-in-chief, not economist-in-chief, not speaker-in-chief. Commander-in-chief. The reason why we have a federal government is to keep us safe. Most of the responsibility of government belongs to the family, the most important government in society, followed by local communities and then states. That is where the power when it comes to government truly resides. The federal government's job is primarily to keep us safe. And I am telling you that it is failing in that regard. I've already described to you our defense cuts, and they are significant. Is there waste? Is there fraud? Is there abuse in the Pentagon? There is, and we should root it out. Every dollar that's wasted is not defending us. But we cannot keep America safe with the smallest army since World War II, the smallest Navy in 100 years, the smallest Air Force ever. That's why, as president, my number one priority on national security is to rebuild the U.S. military, because the world is a safer and better place. When I'm president, we're going to have a real war on terror. A real war, not a rhetorical war on terror. You know, I chuckle. Sometimes I hear people say, we're going to carpet bomb ISIS. We're going to make the sand in the Middle East glow in the dark. By the way, you can't do that if you don't have an Air Force to carpet bomb them with. That's why these defense cuts are so serious. We need to have a real war on terror. It begins by acknowledging who the enemy is. The enemy is a radical movement motivated by their radical interpretation of their faith. In the case of ISIS, it's an apocalyptic movement who believes that their job is to trigger an Armageddon-style showdown in the city of Dubuque. Interesting, a few weeks ago I mispronounced it. I said the city of Dubuque, and people in Iowa freaked out. Dubuque. No, not Dubuque. Dubuque. D-A-B-I-Q. But guys, this is what they believe. They believe that there's going to be this final showdown between the West and them in the city of Dubuque in northern Syria. And when that showdown happens, they're going to win, and the 12th Imam, which is their messianic figure, is going to emerge from hiding, and the whole world is going to have to live under their interpretation of Islam. Now, for you, it sounds like a movie. It sounds like something in a novel. It sounds like something that's never going to happen. That's not the point. The point is that these guys believe. This is what motivates them, and it tells you they're not going to turn into stockbrokers. They're not going to go out and open a chain of car washes. We're either going to have to defeat them or they will defeat us, and they are willing to invest hundreds of years in this. 2 days ago, ISIS executed what they said were 5 British spies. And this guy with those masks that they always wear because they're cowards and never show their face. So with this mask that he wears, with this British accent, he says to the Prime Minister of Great Britain, "You're a fool because you don't understand. We love death as much as you love life." This is who we're dealing with here. Either they win or we win. They must be defeated. And we're going to have a real war on terror. And here's what that's going to look like. The most capable intelligence agencies in the world are going to tell us where they are. The most capable military in the world is going to destroy them. And if we capture any of them alive, they're going to get a one-way ticket to Guantanamo, Cuba, where we're going to find out everything they know. One more point on national security, and then I'll close. I want to say hi to as many of you as I can in person. What we're doing to our veterans in this country is an outrage. It's an outrage. Okay? Record numbers of people in this country, veterans, homeless. Record numbers of veterans, unemployed, locked out of job opportunities. And record numbers waiting in long waiting lines for services from the VA, including my brother. 7th Special Forces Green Beret, 68 through 71, has a dental claim. Every 10 years he has to fight with them over this dental claim. They want him to prove that it happened in the services of our country. And he tells them, the only time I ever jumped out of a plane was in the Army. And that's how he got his teeth knocked out, okay? And his brother's a senator. So just think about that. And even coming to my office, we've had a fight through this bureaucracy. It is ridiculous. For starters, we have to make it easier for veterans when they come back to find a job, which means the skills they picked up or learned in the military should transfer over to civilian life. Let me give you a real world example, okay? Think about this. Think about this. How hard it is to get a commercial trucker's license or something like that, even for a veteran. Here's what I think. If you have been hauling explosives on a dirt road in Afghanistan, I think you're qualified to haul eggs on the interstate highway system of the United States of America. If you served 2 tours of duty in Iraq, I think that's worth at least 3 or 4 credit hours in Middle Eastern affairs at a university. And then the other service on the VA. Look, there are good people working at the VA. I know there are veterans here today, and we thank you for your service. And if you've been to a VA, you know that there are really good people there. They're veterans. They care for the veterans. They work really hard. And then there are some people that are not doing a good job. And those people that are not doing a good job are likelier to get a bonus than they are to be fired. When I'm president of the United States and you work in any agency in government, especially the VA, and you're not doing a good job, you're going to get fired. And one more thing, that veteran's benefit belongs to the veteran, not to the government. Look at the GI Bill. Does the GI Bill say you can only use the GI Bill at West Point, Annapolis, or the Air Force Academy? It says you can take your benefit to any accredited college or university. Why then is the VA benefit not the same? When I'm president, if you're not happy with the VA, if you have to wait too long at the VA, you will be able to take your VA benefits to any doctor or any hospital. So in closing, here's the truth, and it's hard. Here's the truth. The truth is America's still a great country. Nothing like it in the world. But it is a great country in decline. And that's hard to hear. We are on the verge of being the first Americans that leave their children worse off than themselves. If we stay on the road we are on right now, we are going to have to explain to our children and grandchildren why we did this to them and to America. We are on the road to decline, and we are running out of time to fix it. Here's the good news. It doesn't have to remain this way. Because we're not a weak people. We're not a weak nation. We just happen to have a weak president. And this year we're going to change that. And so that's why we can't afford to elect Hillary Clinton to be president. And by the way, she's now really ramped up her attacks on me every day. Yesterday, believe it or not, We couldn't even fly out because her plane was blocking the plane we were supposed to fly on. This is a true story. I'm not saying she did it on purpose, but the other stuff's on purpose. Hillary Clinton does not want to run against me, guys. She does not. But I want to run against her because we're going to win if I do. Hillary Clinton disqualified herself to be commander-in-chief in the way she conducted herself as Secretary of State. There is not a single place in the world where America is stronger or safer than it was before she was Secretary of State or Barack Obama was president. That's her record. She subjected sensitive and even classified American information to being spied on by the Chinese and the Russians. That's her record. And she lied about Benghazi. And she was caught. And she was caught. She was telling the families of those four brave Americans, oh, this was because of a video, a YouTube video, this weird movie they made. That's why this happened. And then she was telling her family, her friends, and even foreign leaders, this was a coordinated terrorist attack. Someone who's willing to lie like that to the American people and the families of those who suffered so greatly, anyone who's willing to do that can never be Commander-in-Chief of the United States. That's also why we can't just elect any Republican, just any Republican. Now look, I'm not here to badmouth the other Republicans. We have a good group of people running. At a minimum, I can say this, none of them is a socialist. None of our candidates is under FBI investigation. So we're already ahead of the curve. But it can't just be any Republican. It's got to be somebody committed to the principles that made America great, that doesn't just believe in them, but that will fight for them. That believes them in their marrow, that will fight for those principles as hard as the left fights for theirs. Because we have a lot of work to do to undo this damage. And one more reason why it can't just be any Republican. Because this election is not just a choice between two political parties. In the end, both political parties have done damage to America over the last 20 and 30 years. This election is a generational choice. It is a referendum on our identity as a nation and as a people. And the question we are being asked is, do you want America to remain great and exceptional? Or do you want it to become just another country? That's what this election is about. For me, it goes even deeper than that. It's very personal. See, America doesn't owe me anything. We don't hear that enough. I remember there was a time just a few decades ago when a Democratic president said to America, ask not what your country can do for you. What can you do for your country? Boy, a very different Democratic Party now. America doesn't owe me anything. I'm not entitled to anything in America. My rights don't come from God. They come from God, not from the government. And America owes me nothing. But I have a debt to America I will never fully repay. Because America is not just the country I was born in. This is the nation that literally changed the history of my family. My parents were not born into privilege or wealth. My father in particular had it very difficult. When he was 4 days shy of his 9th birthday, his mother dies. He's in Cuba, mother dies. And so my father has to stop going to school and he has to start working. He never really went back to school. He would work for the next 70 years of his life. They were frustrated, they couldn't move ahead, and so in 1956, they left their country and came here. They didn't have any money. At the time, they barely spoke any English. They had no real education, and they didn't know anyone. And it was hard. But they worked hard and they persevered. And they never became rich. They never became famous. You never would have heard about them had I not run for office. But my parents were successful people. You know why they were successful? Because they were able, working as a bartender and a maid in a hotel, not unlike this one, except for the slot machines, to own a home in a safe and stable neighborhood. They were able to raise four children in a strong and stable home. They were able to retire with dignity, and they were able to leave all four of those children, including myself, better off than themselves. This is the amazing story of America. That is the American dream. That is what makes us special. Every country in the world has rich people. What makes us so special is here there are millions and millions of people that aren't even trying to be rich. They just want to be happy, and they want the freedom and the opportunity to pursue happiness. And you know why America's a special country? It was not an accident. This didn't happen on its own. America was special because for over 200 years, each generation has done what they needed to do. Each generation has confronted their challenges and embraced their opportunities. And so for 200 years, each generation of Americans has left the next better off than themselves. Now the time has come for us to do our part. Now the moment has arrived for this generation of Americans to confront its challenges and embrace its opportunities. And when I'm president, we will. When I'm president, we are going to return to the principles that made America great, and we are going to apply them to the challenges of this new era. When I'm president, we're not just going to save the American dream. We are going to work every day to expand it, to reach more people, and change more lives than ever before. And when our work is done in this generation, America will still not be perfect, but it will be greater than ever. And the 21st century is not just going to be as good as the 20th century. We are going to make it better. If we do what needs to be done, the 21st century is going to be a new American century. So thank you for hearing me out. God bless you. Thank you.